Hello, everyone, and welcome to Tressel Field here at the George Finnie Stadium on the campus of Baldwin Wallace University. We're here for Ohio Athletic Conference football action as the host Baldwin Wallace Yellow Jackets get set to take on the Wilmington College Quakers. Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Matt Florjancic, and I'm joined by Luke Schradl on the call today. The Yellow Jackets looking to keep the good times rolling after stumbling at Mountain Union in their third game of the year. They have rattled off three straight, and they have looked mighty impressive doing it. They blanked Capital a couple of weeks ago here, and they go on the road last week and handle business against Muskingum 49-10. This is a Yellow Jacket team that is playing better and better as the weeks get later on into the season, and that's exactly what you want to see out of a team that has some playoff aspirations.
Yeah, well, you're right, man. I mean, you know, they came into Mountain Union feeling like they had a chance to beat that team, and you know, they learned a lot from that matchup, and I think that's where they are now. They've learned a lot about this team. They learned what they can do well, and obviously that's running the ball. I think they continue to, you know, pass that 150 yards a game mark where they are undefeated right now at 5-0 after they rush for 150 yards plus. I think you keep the turnover margin, especially in a game where Wilmington College, they're 0-6. You know, you just can't turn the ball over. You have to protect the football and do what they do best, and That's run the ball. That's play strong defense in the linebacking core, and just don't turn it over. They haven't had an interception this year. I almost don't want to say that.
Yeah, don't put the broadcaster jinx on them.
Yeah,
I get you. But, yeah, you're absolutely right. This BW team takes care of the football, and that's what you want. You want a team that can control the clock, and BW can definitely do that because not only do they have the stellar running game, they also have a standout defense, and that defensive line really does a number to wreak havoc in opposing backfields to set them up in second and long and third and long situations, and that helps them get off the field and the offense to get more possessions. So as long as BW can take care of the football and keep that running game effective while also managing the defense and making sure that they do not let Wilmington get any momentum, it should bode well in the Yellow Jackets' favor today. Taking a look at today's contest, it is the third of five regular season home games for the BW Yellow Jackets, and it is their sixth game of the season in the Ohio Athletic Conference. They are 5-1. Actually, they are 5-1 overall, and they are 4-1 in the Ohio Athletic Conference. Today is a special day here at Tressel Field, as it is the 43rd Lee Tressel Shrine Classic game. Last week, BW went down to Zanesville, and they knocked off the Muskingum Fighting Muskies 49-10. Wilmington fell to Marietta 35-7. Wilmington is 0-6 on the year. They are 0-5 in OAC play. Taking a look at the series, previously these two teams have met 21 times on the gridiron, with the Yellow Jackets holding an all-time record of 18-3 against the Quakers, including 11 straight victories. During their winning streak, BW has outscored the Quakers 494-149. The series began in 1922 with Wilmington defeating the Yellow Jackets 16-7 here in Berea. The last time Wilmington came away with a victory was in 2008 when they beat the Yellow Jackets 27-21 down in Wilmington. So we are just about set for kickoff. BW will receive the opening kickoff. Wilmington will defend the south goal here at Tressel Field. So we're going to get a good look at that BW offense right away, Luke, as the Yellow Jackets will get the ball, and no doubt about it, they're going to want to feature John Murray Jr., who comes in to the game having netted 677 yards and scored 12 touchdowns on 119 carries. He's averaging better than 5.5 yards per attempt. And no doubt about it, he was probably number one on the scouting report for Wilmington's defense, and we know that he is one of the top options for the Yellow Jacket offense.
Yep, he's fourth in rushing touchdowns in the country, and there's a big reason why. He's a big guy, gets it done in the trenches, but also what's really important in this game is starting fast. Coach Hilbert talked about that in the post-game interview with me. He said, you know, against Capital, we really wanted our guys to go out there and start fast because, you know, this is a quality opponent that isn't really going to challenge this BW team, but it's what you can do fast, make them get demoralized and basically off the field early, and you can protect your guys and maybe get some more looks deeper down the roster as things go on.
Yeah, and we saw that a couple of weeks ago, just how deep they were able to go into the roster. And then last week as well, four different rushers scored touchdowns. Griffiths and Murray Jr. each had two, and then Ian Mitchell added one, and there was another rushing touchdown in that game. It was just an outstanding effort against Muskingum, and an effort that BW would very much like to duplicate here today. Rocco Del Verme was the fourth running back who scored against Muskingum last week.
Yep, they have eight different rushers to score a touchdown so far this season.
Pop kick along the sideline, and it will skip out of bounds. That's an illegal procedure against Wilmington. BW is going to start with a shorter than expected field.
And that's them being afraid of Ian Mitchell. He's number seven in punt return yardage this year. I know this is a kickoff, but he's just so dangerous back there that you don't even want to kick the ball to him. And that's where that squib kick comes in.
Yeah, he is one of the most dangerous weapons that BW has. And in talking to Coach Hilvert on Monday evening, he clearly thinks that he has the best running back and the best return man in the country. Running back being John Murray Jr. and then Mitchell back as a returner. And I tell you what, it's kind of hard to argue with him the way that those two play. BW comes out with a four wide receiver set. Armitage in at quarterback, John Murray Jr. flanking his right side. Handoff goes inside to Murray, and he is bottled up in the backfield. They're going to generously spot him at a yard loss, and you do not see that very often.
That was a typical read option, but I'm assuming you start with the first play. Just, hey, give it. Let's get our running game going. We don't need to make any mistakes, but I really feel like Keegan could have taken that on the mesh himself. D-line crashed in on John Murray Jr. That's obviously who they're keying on.
Yeah, no doubt. Bunch trips to the bottom of the formation for the Jackets. Armitage hands off inside to John Murray Jr., and he is going to run for the first down and more, but the ball comes out, and Wilmington says they have it, and they do. It's a fumble by John Murray Jr. It was a good run for first down yardage, but maybe just a little bit too much extra effort gave Wilmington enough time to strip the ball.
Yeah, this is John Murray's first fumble loss this season. They've only lost one fumble. Otherwise, you know, they really haven't turned the ball over. That's why I didn't even want to bring it up in the pregame because, you know, it's going to happen right away. But, you know, you've got to bounce back here on this defensive possession. Wilmington has a little bit of momentum, and that's all they need to get something going.
Yeah, no doubt about it. You want to quell as much momentum as you can. Derek Larimar is the quarterback, and he brings it back into the backfield to protect his right side. Handoff goes inside, and that is nothing doing as the Yellow Jacket defense swarms at the point of attack and getting in there for the stop. Teano Orocho and Jordan Smith, two of the three Yellow Jackets that wrapped up the ball carrier in the backfield.
Both of those guys are having big-time seasons. Jordan Smith with 3.5 sacks, 4.5 tackles for a loss. He gets involved in there. And, of course, Teano Orocho, a guy who's been a perennial star player on this defense.
Pass goes out to the left side. It's Amir Johnson on the reception. He gets a modest gain to the Yellow Jacket 44-yard line. So it'll be third and long here for the Quakers and an opportunity for the Yellow Jackets to get off the field.
You get an easy early hookup with quarterback and wide receiver. Just gets your quarterback so much more confidence. I say that all the time, but it really is important, especially coming into a hostile environment like George Finnie Stadium.
Yeah, just something, anything to get positive momentum going, I think, is the key. Shotgun snap, pass again to Johnson on the left side, and he is wrapped up and taken down. Teano Orocho coming up with the stop once again. You don't see a D-tackle track down a wide receiver very often, but in crowded space, Orocho did a good job to make the play that was in front of him.
Really speaks to how athletic he is and the way he plays the game with so much effort.
Yeah, even at a defensive tackle spot, you expect a bigger guy. He's 5'11", but he goes only 195 pounds. So he's on the more of the technique side is how he's going to beat you. And uses athleticism, and he did on that. Quick punt. It'll go over the head of everybody. Bounce it to 10. Wilmington trying to track it down, and they will at the 3-yard line. So BW is going to have a long field but at least they kept the Quakers off the board.
Well, it's a sports special teams move. You know, you don't want to even bring Ian Mitchell back out there to return it. And when you go with a quick punt, I know they've done it a couple times this season, it's just easy to start the game off and play the field position game here, not try to get too aggressive.
Yeah, and it worked. You did what you had to do defensively. You backed them up on first down. You made life difficult on second and third, and you forced the quick kick punt. It's a good first effort by the Yellow Jacket defense. We'll see what's in store for those guys the rest of the way. Armitage will be back in at quarterback. John Murray Jr. on his left side. Two receivers to each side of the formation. Handoff goes inside to Murray. He gets out past the 10-yard line and out to the 12. He's 1 yard short of the first down, and that just looked like an angry run to me. That was a run by a guy who felt like he had something to prove.
Exactly, and there was a giant hole there as well. I mean, if they keep showing him holes like that and he can get as aggressive like that on the runs, I mean, it's going to be all day for him.
Three receivers to the bottom, one at the top of the formation. Armitage again with the inside handoff. Nope, he pulls it back, and he'll get the first down yardage out to the 16-yard line. So that's a first down for the Yellow Jackets.
Great last-second read by Keegan. Knew what the defense was going to do. They've shown their hand a couple of times on those read options, and finally takes it himself, gets up for the first down.
Three receivers and a tight end in the formation. Man in motion is Greg Perry's. He'll motion left and go back right. Handoff goes inside to John Murray Jr. He pushes the pile ahead just shy of the 20-yard line, so a modest gain on the first down carry for John Murray Jr.
And this is what we're used to seeing from this offense, a methodical approach that's safe. And, you know, when you have this great of an offensive line, it's easy to lean on the run.
Yeah, this offensive line, and we will introduce them in a second, is pretty darn impressive. The Yellow Jackets don't have the kind of running game that they do without the offensive line. Read option, Armitage is going to keep it. He's got first down yardage and more out past the 30-yard line, out to the 32. And, again, he did a good job to read where the defense was going, and no surprise, all the attention went to Murray.
Yeah, and Wilmington's going to need to respect Keegan as a runner. He can really run. He's not just your typical pocket passer. He has some quick feet, makes a couple of moves, and usually gets down right. And
122 yards and three touchdowns coming into today's game on 40 carries for Keegan Armitage. And he's not the running quarterback that the Yellow Jackets have. That honor goes to Jack Gibbons. But Armitage doing a job with his feet right now. Now he's going to try to air it out with his arm. He does. He's got Stokes behind coverage at the 20, the 15, 10, 5, touchdown, Yellow Jackets. What a pitch and catch right there to Stokes from Armitage.
And, wow, the run sets up the play action perfectly. Keegan had all sorts of time. And, boom, you get a big, long touchdown to your guy, Darius Stokes, who – has been a leading receiver for this team all year.
And you see why. He was well behind the coverage from Wilmington. He shot right past the DB and ran the perfect post route, and Armitage hung a beauty right up in the air for him to come down with in stride and run in for the touchdown. Dean Saris on to try the extra point. He's 28 of 29 this year. Snap is back, ball is down, kick is up, and we'll have another kick because there is a flag on the play.
Looked like encroachment.
BW will gain about a yard and a half on the penalty, and they'll retry the extra point. Snapping is 6'1", 205-pound junior Max Lambert to quarterback and holder Reese Wehmer. The snap is back, ball down, kick up, and it is good. The Yellow Jackets stake themselves out to a 7-0 lead here in the first quarter, 10-17 left to go in quarter number one at Tressel Field.
It wasn't exactly the start they wanted with that first drive fumble, but you come back and you respond well, and that means a lot. You can only get so much out of these games, and especially against a team that's 0-6. You know, it's tough to even learn anything about your team from this, but you grew in this first quarter no matter what. That was a great response from both the offense and the defense.
Yeah, no doubt about it. I think that's the key here is you saw the growth within the offense just from series one to series two. Look, they had a turnover. Okay, so the defense went out, pitched the three and out, then gave the ball back to the offense. The offense did what they had to do to set up the play action pass, and they executed perfectly. And that's what you're looking to see if you're BW. You're heading toward what you hope is a postseason berth. You want to execute at a high level throughout the second half of the season. We are right next to the coach's box here at Tressel Field, and we have a note from one of the coaches to say hi to Brian, who is listening in Colorado. So, Brian, thank you very much for tuning in to today's game. We hope you enjoy it, and we hope the Yellow Jackets get a win for you. Dean Serres will kick off, and he sets it high, and it'll bounce at the 17, be fielded, but Wilmington will be thrown back to the 10, and they'll give them forward progress, obviously, up to the 17-yard line, but there was nothing doing as Ace Taylor had no room to return the ball.
And you can see how dynamic Jordan Smith is as a defender. He's so powerful to just throw their best offensive player back 5 yards. I mean, that's incredible.
Yeah, you don't see that very often, but, man, that was an impressive bit of coverage right there for the Yellow Jackets. So Larimer back in court at quarterback. Two backs, one on either side. He's looking to pass. He was looking for Jackson, who slipped, and one of the BW defenders, Nick Pankow, had a chance at interception, but that was low and coming in hot, and he wasn't able to corral it.
Yeah, that was interception number two for Nick Pankow waiting for him, and he's the leading tackler on this team. Great in coverage as well.
And 27 solo tackles, 27 assists, 54 total, all team leads on the year. Also has two sacks, five tackles for lost yardage, and an interception. Inside handoff goes to Hobbs, and he's going to be wrapped up after a very short gain. Check that. That was Tyreek Nebbitt on the carry.
Yeah, this Wilmington offense has three different running backs they like to go with. He just happens to be one of them and one of the younger guys on this team as well.
Lots of youth for this Wilmington team as they're looking to build a program. Larimer's pass is off Jackson's hand. He was behind Ian Mitchell, and he had nothing but green in front of him, but that pass was just a bit too long, and that'll be another three and out for this Wilmington offense.
Yeah, and if you're Wilmington, you got to be perfect, and that's a play you really need because that's a big play responding to what BW just did on the last drive.
Oh, absolutely. That was a missed opportunity for the Quakers, and now they're going to have to punt from deep in their own territory. Aaron Pardo is standing at his own 5-yard line. So he, even though the wind is at his back, he's going to have to get a good boot into this one to back the Yellow Jackets up. He averages less than 31 yards per punt. Pardo puts the right foot into it, pops it high and near the Yellow Jackets sideline. It bounces at the 49, rolls to the 35, where Ian Mitchell will be wrapped up and horse collared out of bounds. No call. Yellow Jackets not really happy with that, and nor should they be.
I mean, that was just a great bounce for Wilmington. I don't think that punt could have been better. I thought it was going out of bounds around the 45 of BW, and it bounced all the way back to the 35.
Yeah, it took a nice 14-yard Wilmington roll, so BW will start first and 10 at their own 35-yard line. Elijah Arnett and Andrew Cregan on the left side of the formation. Going in motion is Andrew Bortz. Out on the bottom is Stokes. Handoff goes inside to John Murray Jr. He pushes the ball up to the 41-yard line. So good gain on first down. And while we have this opportunity, want to shout out the offensive line and introduce those young men to you. Starting at left tackle is 6'3" senior Liam Lovetto. At left guard, 6'3" junior George Newcomb. At center, 5'10" senior Javon Megadurchian. Right guard, 6'2" senior Patrick Simon. And right tackle, 6'4" senior Austin Stafford. Fake handoff to Murray. Armitage keeps it. He pushes past the first down marker. Gets about two more out to the 47-yard line. Another first down for the Jackets.
Armitage broke two tackles there. And they don't say he's a runner, but, I mean, he's powerful. He's got the build to be a great runner.
6'2", 214, when he turns his shoulders to the line of scrimmage and gets downhill, I don't care what anybody says, that's a load to handle. Stokes, the lone receiver on the right side. Now they'll move Cregan in motion from left to right. Armitage in the shotgun. He'll hand off to Murray. Murray jump steps, looking for a hole, and he's not going to find one as Wilmington bottles him up after a one-yard gain.
Nice tackle by Traquez Parks. Gets out there on the edge and makes a solo tackle on a guy who's having a great season.
That's a free safety coming up to make that hit at the near the line of scrimmage. He leads Wilmington with 38 total tackles coming into today's game. Second and nine from the 48. Fake handoff to Murray. Armitage keeps it again. He's in Wilmington territory, and he's up close to a first down. Looks like he's a yard short. Again, with the read option, Murray got absolutely destroyed by a defensive end, but that created a huge gap for Armitage.
And now you're in third down and short. You might be able to take a shot being in enemy territory. Definitely in fourth down territory as well.
Handoff goes inside. Murray is spun down for a one-yard loss at the 45. Now it's fourth and two in decision time for the Yellow Jackets.
And they decide to bring out a punter who has punted it 11 times inside the 20. They really trust their defense here with this decision. I especially don't mind it in the first quarter. You don't want to go too aggressive. And, you know, your punter's having a great season.
Yep, no doubt about it. Just two touchbacks and 11 inside the 20. That's a pretty impressive ratio for Nick Cuppage. Cuppage puts the right foot into it, pops it up, skies it, bounces at the 21, rolls down inside the 10, down to the 8, maybe the 7-yard line. A nice Yellow Jacket roll. So Cuppage answers the 14-yard roll on Wilmington's punt with 14-yard roll of his own. .636 here to go in quarter number one. BW leading Wilmington 7-0. Wilmington about to start another offensive series, and they have a long way to go before they hit pay dirt, as it is first and 10 from their own 7-yard line. Fake handoff inside. Larimer is going to keep it, get out past the 10, short of the 11-yard line. So gain of about 3 on that first down carry.
Probably their best first down play yet.
Dallas Rawlings, the freshman running back, is in the backfield flanking the quarterback on the left side. He'll take the handoff, try to run around left tackle. He'll be swarmed at the 10 and taken down for no gain. Coming up with the stop was middle linebacker Mason Levisor. Good job by Mason to sniff that play out.
And he's having a great season as well. His whole linebacking core has really been doing well. And Levisor personally has 33 total tackles.
Run by Wilmington's quarterback. Ball pops loose, and the Yellow Jackets recover it. The official on the sideline is calling for a timeout. The referee is saying the ball was tipped. So we will see after a brief conference who wins out here.
It's a really tough call to make from here, because if we don't have instant replay, we can't see if he was trying to throw that ball. And to me, it looked like he was past the line of scrimmage. So that would be a fumble.
And it will be a fumble, as the Yellow Jackets will recover the ball at Wilmington's 14-yard line. So huge turn of events there, as on third and long, Wilmington tried to run, and Larimer fumbled the football. Murray, the lone back in the backfield, flanking Armitage on the left side. Cregan goes in motion from left to right. Handoff inside, fake handoff inside. Armitage trying to throw it and stepping up in the passing lane. One of the linebackers for this Wilmington defense. It looks like Tavion Bryant got a hand on the ball, and he almost got the turnover right back for the Quakers.
It was kind of just maybe a bit early on the throw. I feel like he could have waited for that route to develop just a little bit more, but decided to get it out quick. Pressure was coming.
Two tight ends set. Bartosik on the left side. Cregan goes motion right to left. Murray in the backfield. Armitage takes a snap. Hands off inside. John Murray trying to get to the outside. Gets it to 10. Gets it to 5. Dives for the end zone. It's a touchdown for the Yellow Jackets.
And there's number 13 on the year. He's eaten up. And that'll push him forward on the NCAA leaders in rushing touchdowns.
I cannot get over or fully emphasize just how special John Murray Jr. is. And when he's motivated as he is now after that fumble on the opening drive, motivated John Murray Jr. is a dangerous John Murray Jr. Saris' extra point try is up, and it splits the uprights. It's 14-0 in favor of the Yellow Jackets. 5:14 to go in quarter number one.
That looked like it might have been good from 40 yards out.
Yeah, it had the distance on it. You never worry about Saris' distance. It's just a matter of whether that ball curves once it gets into the air. And that, by the way, that was with a crosswind going from right to left across the line of scrimmage. So a little bit of a challenge for these specialists here to place the ball exactly where they want.
Yeah, it's a 10-mile-per-hour wind. It still has a little bit of an effect on the ball, but we haven't seen it affect Saris too much today.
Not yet, and hopefully that's the case. We already got the turnover out of the way with the broadcaster jinx, so let's not put the hex on poor Dean Saris quite yet, or Nick Cuppage for that matter. Saris will tee it up at the 35, and he'll send it away back deep to return Traquez Parks and Ace Taylor. Amir Jackson also there to return. He'll field it at the 5, get it past the 20, and he'll be stopped short of the 25. Call it the 24-yard line where Wilmington will set up shop and look to get something going positively for the offense.
Yeah, I think they need to execute better if they want to be in this game. And you saw it with the big pass where he just off the left tip of his hand could have had a touchdown, and then you come back and fumble the ball. And that's Larimer's third fumble. When you get outside of the pocket, you really got to protect the football because you're the quarterback. Everybody wants to lay the boom on you, and you got to protect that football.
Yeah, no doubt. That is job number one, probably job number one, two, and three for the quarterback is to take care of the ball. Shotgun snap. Larimer flares it out to Hobbs on the right side and overshot the screen pass. The ball goes out of bounds. So incomplete pass on first and 10, and it'll bring up second and long.
Play was read well by a veteran player, Sekou Amani. He got out there and made sure that bubble wasn't completed.
If I'm a receiver or running back and I see Sekou Amani in my direct line of sight, I know I'm probably about to have a really bad day. This is a young man that can impact the ball game in just about any way. We'll get to his stat line after this snap, but it's a pretty impressive one. Larimer steps up in the pocket looking to throw. He does. He dumps it over the middle, and it is complete to Gavin Fouché up to the 32-yard line. He'll be 2 yards short of a first down.
That time, Sekou just took Dylan Folley and just ran right past him with one move. Larimer does a good job of stepping up in the pocket and delivering over the middle.
Sekou Amani stands 6'2", weighs in at 230 pounds. The senior has 5 solo tackles and 5 assists, 10 total, 2 sacks, 4.5 tackles for lost yardage. And rushing in to get the sack is Nick Pankow. Pankow just shot right past the left tackle and was able to get in the backfield and bring Larimer down.
And he's just such an impact player, isn't he? I mean, he's in every single play, it feels like, for this team. He's all over.
That was the third sack of the season for Pankow. I think Nick might have heard us rattling off Sekou Amani's stats and been like, I'm pretty good, too. Let me get my name out there, too. Snap is back. Pardo puts the right foot into it, and he'll spiral it towards the sideline where it will bounce into the Wilmington bench. And just as you said the last time, they are not going to let Ian Mitchell ruin this game.
Yeah, it's pretty clear what their game plan is. Kick it on the sideline, outside the hashes. Do not let this guy touch the ball. And when you can make special teams unit respect you that much, it really affects the game. And he's just such an impact player.
No question about that. That is a young man that can negatively impact the game if you're looking at it from an opposing perspective. BW with a first and 10 at their own 39-yard line. Armitage in at quarterback. He'll send Bortz in motion. Now back right. Fake the pass to Bortz. He's looking long down the field, but not finding anybody. He'll dance out of the pocket. Throw it to Stokes on the right side. He's across midfield, down close to the 40-yard line. That's a first down for the Yellow Jackets. And, you know, we talk about this offensive line in terms of their road grading ability running the football. Keegan Armitage needs to give those guys a hearty high five and a thank you on that one, because they gave him about 7 seconds to throw the ball.
Yeah, he was all day, had all day, and really nothing was open on the starting of these patterns. And Darius Stokes does what he's taught, come back to your quarterback and help him out, make a play, and that time he finds the hole in the zone and makes the catch.
Three receivers out top, Cregan in motion from right to left, Murray in the backfield. Fake the handoff inside. He'll throw it out to Cregan. Cregan at the 40, turns the corner at the 35, and gets down close to the first down marker. Looks like he's going to be about a yard short.
Great job by Andrew Bortz to set the edge with that block there. I thought he might have held, but it was a block that held up and allowed his teammate to get the edge for a big gain.
That's one thing that BW's wide receivers don't get enough credit for. Yes, they have a lot of playmakers, but they're great blockers too. And you have to be when you have an offense that runs through the running back like a John Murray Jr. You have to be willing to sell out and commit to run blocking as well.
Exactly.
Murray Jr. gets the handoff. He's across the 25, down to the 20, and he is going to have first down yardage and plenty more on that carry.
The BW offense has him exactly where they want him. I mean, they're really respecting the pass now with those couple of long hookups and the play action that got him the big touchdown. They're a little bit less keying in on John Murray because everybody else has been helping out.
Yeah, that was as big of a gap as Murray has seen all day. And just like that, he'll get another one as he gets past the 15, bounces it to 10, powers to the 5, and he's down to the 1 yard line. First down for the Yellow Jackets, first and goal from Wilmington's 1 yard line.
And you just got to have the feeling that they're going to give it to him again.
Yeah, I mean, it's pretty good success. Armitage gets the snap. He'll hand off to Murray Jr. Murray Jr. gets spun down inside the 1.
It was a good push by the Wilmington defense, but it looked like John Murray just tripped himself up there.
Yeah, and that's one he's going to look back on the film session and probably not be very happy with. Yellow Jackets going with a bigger set, though, as they have two tight ends in the formation. Bartosik on the right side. Cregan in a motion to the left. Murray Jr. gets the handoff from Armitage, and he powers behind the block from Cregan into the end zone for the Yellow Jacket touchdown, his second rushing score of the day.
Keep adding him on, and, you know, a guy that averages 5 yards for carry, why not give him the ball inside the 10 two times in a row?
Yeah, he's earned that right to carry that ball, and there's no doubt about that. Dean Saris to try that point after. Wehmer to hold. Lambert to snap. Snap back. Ball down. Kick up. And the kick is good. BW now leads the Wilmington Quakers 21-0 with 1:01 left here in the first quarter from Tressel Field.
And that's the quick start that Coach Hilbert wants. A 21-0 first quarter. Looking good.
Yeah, and take into account that this first quarter started with a John Murray Jr. fumble on what would have been a first down run. That was the first possession of the game for the Yellow Jackets. They received the kickoff, so momentum was starting to build potentially towards Wilmington's favor, and BW stamped that out. They have forced several three and outs, and every time since, the offense has found pay dirt. Saris charges the ball, puts the right foot into it, pops it high into the air. It's fielded at the 14-yard line. Amir Jackson looking for a lane to the outside, and he'll find a modest one as he gets the ball to the 29-yard line. Wilmington will start first and 10 in their own territory.
And one thing looking at this Wilmington offense is they stay committed to the run, no matter how far they're down they are. And I like that they've been doing that. You know, you give up 52 points per game, you can't let what the other team's doing affect what your game plan is. And they've come out here with a balanced attack, but just haven't executed the way they wanted to.
No, it's been tough sledding so far. We'll see if Wilmington can do anything on this drive here. Tyreek Nebbitt with the ball. Or with the carry, rather, and he'll get up to the 34-yard line. So a 5-yard gain on first down, and that's two straight series-opening positive plays for Wilmington, as on their last drive they had a good positive gain on first down as well. Larimer will pitch it to a wide receiver who is crossing the formation, taking the pitch. It was Jamon Clark, and he has first down yardage. That's the first time we're saying that today for Wilmington.
It's a great play call. You play to your strengths as an offensive coordinator, and I think you got the speed on the outside, a couple of wide receivers that can make blocks, and that's when the jet sweep really works for you.
Wilmington does not have to run another play, but it looks like they're going to try. Fake the handoff inside. Lermer's going to step up and take it himself. He slides down at the 44-yard line, and he'll gain just 2 yards on first down. That'll be the final play of the first quarter, where the Yellow Jackets hold a 21-0 lead over the Wilmington Quakers here at Tressel Field at the George Finnie Stadium. Matt Florjancic and Luke Schradel on the call for you today. And given the circumstances that BW started with a fumble on their opening possession, a 21-point lead after the first quarter is a very good way to bounce back.
Yeah, you're playing to your game plan and really doing a nice job on offense, and the defense really has been absolutely perfect through this first quarter.
And just giving up one first down thus far in the game, that is an impressive feat for the Yellow Jacket defense.
And they're playing big on the money now, third down. 0-4 for Wilmington, and that's credit to the BW defense as well.
Second and 8. The handoff goes inside. It's Nebbitt, and he'll push it close to midfield out to the 48-yard line. So we'll bring up third down.
Third down and manageable. A lot of options. Let's see what they go with here. It's got to be a play that is up there in the playbook with your best plays, because this is an important third down and a total breaking point in this game.
No question. This will be good bit of momentum here if Wilmington can convert to third down. Handoff goes inside to Nebbitt. He's hit and dropped at the line of scrimmage. No surprise who's in on the stop. Nick Pankow comes up and gets the tackle. Fourth and 4, and Wilmington will be forced to punt it away once again. Ball is spotted at the Wilmington 48-yard line. Now Wilmington will burn their first timeout of the half.
And if you're Wilmington here, why punt it? You're down 21-0. You have nothing to lose. I don't know why you wouldn't put your offense out there, especially when your defense is having a tough time stopping the run game. And it's just going to continue to add up if you punt it here, I think.
Yeah, I agree. At this point, you don't really have anything to lose. And you've shown that Amir Jackson and some of the other wide receivers in the formation can get behind the yellow jacket coverage. If you can find a quick slant to Jackson, you can get this first down.
I think they agree with us.
Yeah, it sure looks like they do as Lorimer is back on the field for fourth down and four. Yep, now he's going to drop back and look to quick punt it after the attempt at a hard count, and he'll get a nice roll as that ball will roll down to about the 7-yard line. The Yellow Jackets have a long field to go once again. It's like Jordan Smith and one of the Quakers had an interesting exchange there that the officials had to step in and break up, as did some of his teammates.
Yeah, no need for extracurriculars, up 21-0 in the second quarter. Stay focused.
Yeah, absolutely. You don't want to get anybody hurt, get anybody in trouble with a suspension potentially. You just play the game and let the problems work themselves out over time. Cregan pulled in tight on the right side. Armitage will take the snap, hand off to John Murray Jr. He bounces off left tackle, gets to the 10, out to the 15, past the 20, and he gets pushed into the Yellow Jacket sideline after getting a first down out to the 24-yard line.
That time running behind Cregan. Made a nice block at the point of attack and lets John Murray get outside the numbers.
Tell you what, the Yellow Jackets have really done an outstanding job of making it fun to be at the games when they have the bells ringing on third down when the defense is out there. And after that rush, I laughed to myself because John Murray Jr. got the first down, but then they played the old Legion of Doom WWF theme music to celebrate the gain. Armitage airing it out long down the left side, and he put way too much behind the ball. Steve Thompson, the athletic director here at Baldwin Wallace, with a nice catch, though.
Yeah, sure, handed on the sideline.
Yeah, very much so. That was impressive.
Yeah, and Stokes had a chance there one-on-one, and, you know, you give your guy a chance. I love going for the big shot on second down after you had a nice couple of run plays to get you the first down. But
yeah, you might as well take the shot. You've proven that Stokes can get behind this defense, so take another chance. You never know what could happen. Handoff goes inside. It's John Murray Jr. He's bottled up, but now he's going to bounce it left side. Get to the 30, get taken down by the back of the jersey. And falls awkwardly to the turf, but fortunately for the Yellow Jackets, he springs right back up, and he is none too pleased about that play.
Traquez Parks there to make the play again. You can tell why he's the leading tackler on this defense. He's a great athlete, gets to the ball well, and in pursuit there does a nice job.
Came into the game with 20 solo tackles, 18 assists, 38 for the total for the year, leading the team. He's one of these impact players for the Wilmington defense. Armitage fakes the inside handoff. Now looks to pass, but now he's just looking to hold on to the ball as he gets smashed by about 7 different defenders. And that'll bring up fourth down, and it'll be a punting situation for the Yellow Jackets.
And Wilmington trusted their defense punting it there on 4th and 5 at the midfield line, and that decision pays off here.
You know, I tell you what, BW was lucky that Armitage was able to hold on to the ball because Wilmington was giving him fits trying to strip the ball. When you have 6 or 7 guys that outweigh you trying to strip the ball out and you're able to hold on, you're very fortunate. Nick Cuppage on to do the punting duties, and he'll run to the right side and put his right foot into it, and that partially got blocked, and Ian Mitchell will track it down just outside the 35-yard line out at the BW 36. So somebody broke contain, got through, and got a piece of the ball.
I think one of the personal protectors didn't have a great block and maybe got a pinky or something on that ball.
It wasn't much because the ball still had some distance on it, but still not exactly the best situation for the Yellow Jackets special teams unit. And now Wilmington is on a very short field, first and 10 from the BW-36. Handoff goes to Rawlings, the 5'10", 200-pound freshman, tried to run around right tackle, and he was met in the backfield for a four-yard loss.
Yeah, Timmons does a great job of setting the edge. That's exactly what you want him to do. Make sure that running back goes inside, and that time you want him to cut it outside, and there's Timmons to say, no, I'm bringing you down right here for a loss.
Timmons matches Rawlings' size perfectly. He's 6 foot, 200 pounds, and the senior with 8 total tackles, including 1.5 for lost yardage. Now make that 2.5 for lost yardage on the season. Lerner looking to pass. He tries to step up in the pocket, but he's going to be wrapped up and taken down. It's Jordan Smith coming in with the sack.
And the protection was really good there. The routes just didn't develop downfield the way that Larimer wanted it to, and that's a coverage sack.
R.J. Pegues also stepped up and got the assist on the sack, so Jordan Smith got a little bit of help to end that play, and now it's 3rd and 19 from the 45. Lerner pump fakes. Now he's looking to throw it, but he's going to be wrapped up and dropped on the other side of the 50-yard line. It's Sekou Amani coming up with a huge play on 3rd down, and that is a monster loss of yardage.
Yeah, everybody got in there that time, and especially Sekou. Great push by the D-line. If you're the Wilmington offensive line, you can't have good protection on 3rd down. I said it was a coverage sack. Obviously, this BW defense heard me, and they got after it on 3rd down.
12-yard loss, 4th and 31. Yikes. There's not many plays in the playbook for that one. Pardo to punt. He puts his right foot into it, and it will bounce at the 27, be fielded by Ian Mitchell, and he'll be dropped inside the 15-yard line. There was no space for Mitchell to do anything, but he was so hungry to get his hands on the ball, he was willing to take the risk.
Yeah, when you're that good, you like taking risks, and I feel like he could have had the outside if he maybe broke one tackle there, but that's going to go down as not good for the punt return average.
No, not at all, but BW retains possession, and they will start with a 1st and 10 from their own 15-yard line. 9:07 to go here in the second quarter. BW looking to add on to their 21-0 lead over Wilmington. Bortz in motion from right to left. Handoff goes inside to John Murray Jr. He powers out to the 20-yard line. Actually, they're going to mark him short of the 20 at the 19. 4-yard gain on 1st down. Arnett and Bortz, the receivers on the bottom of the formation. Cregan tight left, Stokes out top. Murray in the backfield, and he'll get the handoff. He'll spin past the 20-yard line and out to the 24-yard line. He'll be a yard short, third and one for the Yellow Jackets.
And this team also, this BW team also, top in time of possession. And you could see why. You know, they run the ball on 1st down. They come back. You know, you got 4 yards. Might as well do it again on 2nd down. And clock keeps ticking here in the second quarter.
And fast moving first half here from Tressel Field. Armitage hands off to Murray. He powers past the 1st down marker out to the 27. Yellow Jacket 1st down.
This Wilmington defense is starting to tire out a little bit. You can tell they've been on the field all day, and they've been getting it run down their throats.
It'd be hard to figure that they wouldn't get tired given how much wear that the Yellow Jackets have put on them running the football. And again, they stay on the ground. It's John Murray Jr. gaining 1 yard out to the 28-yard line. Second and nine for the Yellow Jackets as we approach the seven-minute mark here in the second quarter. Arnett, the lone receiver out top. Stokes, the lone receiver to the bottom. Two tight end set for the Yellow Jackets. Handoff goes to Murray. He gets past the 30-yard line out to the 35. Call it the 37. And that is going to be right at the chains. And that's another first down for the Yellow Jackets.
And John Murray almost lost his footing at the beginning of that play. It rained a little bit earlier in the day and overnight. So this field is still a little bit wet, and you can see why. And he's slipped a couple times already this game.
Yeah, he has, but he was able to still maintain enough of his balance to get things rolling again and get a positive gain. Griffiths with the ball. He'll run around right side to the 40, out to the 50, and he gets run out of bounds at the Wilmington 48-yard line. That was a very nice run by DJ Griffiths.
Griffiths showing his speed. You know, it's been him and John Murray recently as the main two backs, and he's been the guy that's kind of been able to relieve John Murray. He's also a powerful runner, but he has that big-time speed that can get outside the numbers and get going for a first down there.
Yeah, if you're an opposing coach, you don't want to see that guy turn in the corner very often on your defense because that means nothing good is happening. Arnett out to the bottom of the formation. Stokes out top. Cregan motions from right to left, now serving more of an H-back role in front of Griffiths. Griffiths gets the handoff. Bounces off of one would-be tackler, but he's not going to bounce off of the second one, and he'll be hit in the backfield for a 3-yard loss to the BW side of the 50 at the 49.
And you could tell he wanted to get outside in space again, but sometimes you just got to go north-south right there. Probably would have been the best option. But still, you got to come back on second down and make a play.
So second and 13 from the BW 49. Four receiver set, two to the bottom, two to the top. Stokes, the wide man on the numbers out top. Arnett on the numbers on the bottom. Fake inside handoff. Pass down to Cregan. He's in Wilmington territory to the 35-yard line. That's another first down for the Yellow Jackets. Armitage is extremely good at pulling that ball in on the read option and firing it down the field.
Yeah, it was an RPO there. Lineman block like it's a run play and make the linebackers kind of mess up their coverage, and that time Cregan slips out of the backfield and makes a nice catch.
Armitage will fake the handoff again. He drops back, puts it up in the air, looking for Mitchell down the sideline. He catches it, and it's a touchdown for the Yellow Jackets.
And Armitage with a little shimmy afterwards. You could tell how perfect that throw was. I mean, it was on an absolute rope to Ian Mitchell. He had the speed to go up there and get it. That's knowing who you got out there. Yeah. Keegan Armitage, perfect play for him.
Back corner fade route, Armitage to Mitchell. Touchdown, Yellow Jackets. 4-score lead now for BW in the latter stages of this second quarter. Saris on to try the extra point, and it'll be good again. He is 4 of 4 on the day. And he stakes BW out to a 28-0 lead over Wilmington with 4:43 to go here in the first half. Wow. Just when we start talking about the running game, again with the play action to hit Ian Mitchell for the touchdown.
And you talked about it at the top. You know, this team has gotten better every single week, and you can really see how well this passing game has developed. And the time they put in practice to make that type of throw and have that type of timing, that's just beautiful.
Couldn't have said it any better myself. That is the offense that BW wants to have. They want to be explosive. They want to be multidimensional. They want to get everybody involved, and we are seeing it today. Everybody who has stepped onto the field has had a positive impact for the BW Yellow Jackets. Sarah's set to kick it away. Taylor and Jackson back deep to return. Saris with the line drive kick, and it will bounce at the 3. It'll hook at the 2, so Taylor has to pick it up inside the 5. He spins out of one tackle, but he's not going to spin out of the second one, and he is shy of the 10. No, they're going to mark him at the 10-yard line. So he was expecting that ball to go into the end zone, and it took a funny carom on him, and it went right back to him, and he had to make a decision to pick it up and run with it.
And that's the scariest play on special teams. You got to be able to read if that ball is going to the end zone or not, because you got guys running at about 21 miles per hour coming after you, ready to make a tackle.
And that combination, not good. You don't want to see that. If you're a special teams coordinator and you see a guy on a kickoff return let the ball bounce shy of the end zone, bad things tend to happen. So Wilmington fortunate to retain possession. They're going to look to get something rolling here. First and 10 from their own 10-yard line. Fake handoff. Larimer is going to keep it himself. He's going to slide out to the 16. And now they're going to mark him at the 15. And modest gain of 5 yards on first down.
That's probably the biggest hole that any Wilmington rusher has had to run through in. That was probably a called quarterback run on that play.
It sure looked like it was designed that way. And, again, Wilmington hasn't had many rushing lanes in this first half. So credit to the Yellow Jacket defense for stepping up and making the plays that are out there to make. Larimer looking to pass. He's looking over the left side, and Jackson is going to have it batted away. Levasseur was in to get a hand on it. Jackson not happy. Felt he was interfered with, and maybe the defender got there a hair early, but, again, you can't rely on getting those calls.
And regardless, in comes Teono Orocho and Seiko Omani on a passing third down.
And, gee, I wonder what they're in there for. They're in there to wreak havoc, and they are very good at their jobs. Larimer looking to pass again. He doesn't feel a pressure from Omani. Strip sack, and Omani and Orocho jump on the ball. It'll be Yellow Jacket football inside the Wilmington 20 at the 15. Seiko Omani coming from the weak side with the strip sack and the recovery.
Dylan Folley maybe got one finger on Seiko Omani on that pass protection, and he just bowled right past him, had a total free shot at the QB, and he even goes ahead and picks up his own fumble forced.
Yeah, he was literally laying on the ground and saw the ball was right next to him, and with his left hand kind of pawed it back to himself and maintained possession, and that's when Orocho kind of jumped on top of him. Maybe Omani and Orocho can have a nice laugh about a little bit of friendly fire on that one. First and 10, Yellow Jackets. Ball at the Wilmington 15-yard line. Two tight ends set. Two wide receivers in the formation. Murray, the lone back in the backfield. Armitage takes the snap. He hands off to Murray. Murray inside the 15, and he'll power his way down to the 11. 4-yard gain on first down.
Nice tackle by Jared Lee. He's a DB that leads his team in sacks, and that just kind of tells you how their defensive line hasn't played up to what they really wanted them to do. But he comes in, makes the play.
You don't see a DB leading in sacks too often, that's for sure. Armitage with the fake draw. He's going to loft it to Stokes in the end zone. It's batted away. Jalon Covington with the pass breakup. Good coverage right there by Covington. His back was to the ball, but he read Stokes' eyes and was able to get his right hand up in the passing lane.
Yeah, well said, partner. That's all instincts. And that's, you know, we've been here before. We got to make a stop in the red zone. Man-to-man against the best receiver on this team. He makes a play.
Third and 6 from the 11, 2:55 to go here in the first half. Armitage fakes a handoff, and he's going to recover his own fumble, fortunately, as he and John Murray Jr. just not on the same page on that one. And lost yardage out to the 16, so a net of negative 1 yard on that drive, and BW is going to call on the field goal unit.
It's a disappointing result on offense, but got to get the points here.
The ball will be spotted at the 23-yard line for Dean Saris's attempt, so a 33-yard try. His long of the year is 35, and he's hit that twice. Lambert's snap is high, but ball is down. Kick is up, and it is no good. Serres pulls it wide left. He's now 3 of 6 on the season on those field goal attempts. So that drive was all sorts of wrong for the Yellow Jackets. Nothing seemed to go right.
Yeah, execution wasn't perfect, and Serres was just a couple inches off that left upright. But yeah, that's what you talked about. He has the power. Just got to be able to put that thing inside the uprights there. That's his range. You know, you need to be confident in a guy to be able to hit a 35-yarder.
Yeah.
And I'm still confident in him. I think he's a really great kicker for this team, but need that.
He's shown he can do it. It's just a matter of consistency. And the 6-foot, 160-pound junior is going to work on his technique throughout the week and try to better it for next week's game and also the second half as well this game when he watches at halftime. Larimer swings it out to Taylor on the left side. Taylor's up past first down yardage, depending upon the spot. He was ridden out of bounds, but should have enough or pretty close to a first down.
Gavin Fouché with a nice block on the outside, and that's what you need on those bubble screens, a guy that's scrappy that can get in there and make a big-time block.
Second and three, and we're going to hit the two-minute mark, and now Larimer is going to swing it out to one of the wide receivers on the right side of the formation, making the play. Akita Wynn Jr. with the first down reception.
And he's a big part of this offense. He has 26 catches on the year for 324 yards and a touchdown. He's the guy that they need to get going.
And one of their leading receivers, actually, is their leading receiver, and I believe that's the first time he's gotten a touch today. Bunch receivers, trips out top. Lermer's looking to send it to the left side. He does. It's Jackson catching the ball at the 33, pushing it up to the 36. Gain of 3. On first down.
You know, typically you keep running the play. If it works, they got to stop it. And the problem with that here is that we have 1 minute on the clock till halftime, and you need to push this ball at least over midfield and make sure that BW can't score and that maybe you can get into some scoring range here.
Yep, for sure. If you're BW, you want to make sure you keep that zero up on the scoreboard here. Wilmington not doing much in the way of pushing towards that as getting the carry. Tyreek Nebbitt, he'll get first down yardage out to the 45, but again, the clock will start to run when the ball is set. Wilmington not showing any signs they're going to use these two timeouts they have left.
And I think that's a smart move. You really don't want to get this BW offense on the field again. Your defense hasn't been playing the worst, but your offense just has not gone anywhere. You got to stick to the game plan no matter what time is on the clock, I think.
Fake handoff inside now to Wynn Jr. on the right. He gets up to midfield and 1 yard more out to the BW 49-yard line, and that may be the last play of the first half. 10 seconds and counting. And Wilmington's players are looking to the sideline. Hey, coach, we still have time left. And after wasting about 15 seconds, Wilmington calls a timeout.
And I guess the idea here is you get one shot at the end zone. Maybe they didn't think they had enough offensive production to get down there, but I feel like you got to manage the clock better.
Yeah, not a particularly great situation right there. Maybe a missed opportunity for this Quakers team, but like you said, you know, there's a balance to it. You want to be aggressive and you want to give your offense a shot, and they were finally moving the ball positively on consecutive plays, but then you don't want to risk a mistake and then having BW take advantage. Second and 4 from the BW 49-yard line. 5 seconds to go in the first half. Wilmington looking for a positive final play before going in the locker room. Currently, they are down by 28 points. BW in a full prevent defense. The pitch on the run goes to Jamon Clark, and he's wrapped up on the Wilmington side of the 50-yard line for a 2-yard loss, and that will do it for the first half of action here at Tressel Field inside the George Finnie Stadium. The Baldwin Wallace Yellow Jackets hold a 28-0 lead over the Wilmington Quakers. And while Luke and I step away for our halftime break, we're going to turn things over to the BW Marching Band and let you hear some of the great musicians that BW has coming out to the football games every year this year. We'll be back with second half action in just a few moments.
Good afternoon, BW fans. It's time to put your hands together. Let's get ready to rumble with your BW Marching Yellow Jackets. Under the direction of Dr. Andrew Mockimer, percussion advisor Daryl Micah, Brandon Hine, trumpet coach David Kinney, color guard Kelsey Amidon. The BW Marching Yellow Jackets are proud to share some of their favorite songs with you, starting with Take On Me. Thank you.
hit song, American Woman, was released by the Guess Who in 1970 and by artist Lenny Kravitz in 1999. A major hit each time. Our arrangement will feature our very own BW twirler, Emily Garrett. Enjoy American Woman. Substantial success. Clap, cheer, sing along with the BW Marching Yellow Jackets as we perform our rendition of Bye Bye Bye. Thank you.
Welcome back to the George Finnie Stadium. OAC football on Yellow Jacket, BWYellowJackets.com. Luke Schradl joined by Matt Florjancic. BW is up by 28-0 against the Wilmington College Quakers on the 43rd Lee Tressel Shrine game. And it's been all BW so far in the half. They've showed a balanced attack. They had two passing touchdowns, two rushing touchdowns. John Murray added to his total. And he is now up to 122 rushing yards on the game. What do you make of this BW offense so far?
Outside of the turnover on the first drive of the game, they've done everything that they've wanted to do. They've used the run to set up the pass. They've used the play action to keep the defense honest and then open up big holes for John Murray Jr. And when you have that kind of complementary offense, good things are going to happen, and that's exactly what we saw in that first half. And they were able to wear down Wilmington and put four straight scoring drives together. I think that speaks well to the potential that the Yellow Jacket offense really does have.
Yeah, and it wasn't just the offense. It was also the defense. A whole bunch of sacks, and Sekou Imani with three total sacks and a forced fumble we saw late in that second quarter. It's been all three phases of the game for this team, really. And we saw a similar game against Capital. This team has come out and dominated, and they're showing you why they're the number 25 team ranked nationally. Dean Saris ready to do the kicking to start this second half here at home. Back to receive that kick. It's Amir Jackson, along with Atika Wynn Jr. Excuse me, that's Jamon Clark out there. High booming kick, not going to go to the end zone, but Amir Jackson says we'll take it out past the 10, up to the 15, now 20, 25, going to be brought down at around the 32-yard line.
30-yard return right there. Good blocking as Jackson started off on the right numbers and was able to cut across all the way back to the left side of the field to gain that yardage.
And that's where Derek Larimer will bring out the Quakers offense. No points on the board yet for them, but they've stick to the gameplay, Matt.
You know, the short passing routes have been really good for them for the most part, and I would really like to see them get back to it to see if they could kind of start to build some positive momentum with those plays.
Here's Larimer on first down, looking to pass down the field, has his man, and it's caught. Ace Taylor makes the catch into BW territory.
Okay, so maybe the medium passing game is going to work now for Wilmington, as we talked about the short passing game. They have athletes that can make plays. They just have to get the ball to them in space, and they haven't been able to do it thus far. That's one of the bigger plays that Wilmington has had. They only had 51 yards of total offense in the first half, and that was a 20-plus yard gain.
Four receivers set at the 45 of BW for Wilmington. Larimer sends a man in motion, hands off up the middle. That's Hobbs. He's going to push forward for a modest gain, about 4 yards on the play.
Yeah, just some good hard running inside by Hobbs right there.
Good first two plays for the Wilmington Quakers out of the halftime break, down 28. This time, Larimer, four receivers. Dobbs to his left in the shotgun. Sends Itika Wynn into the backfield. Now out to the left. Fakes the handoff. Looking to pass now. Fires over the middle. That's caught by Amir Jackson. He's going to push forward for some extra yardage after the catch. Nearly down into the red zone. About the 21-yard line is where they're spotted. Wilmington offense looking like they need to improve in the second half.
They're going to outgain the offense of the first half total here on this first drive if they get another first down.
Here's Larimer now. First down. Fakes the pass. Runs up the middle, and Teyono Orocho was there. The pump fake on the outside to the bubble wasn't there. Read well by the BW defense.
Yeah, that's a guy that once he gets his hands on you, unless you're very, very strong and still have your balance, you're going down, and you're going down quickly.
Nearing the red zone is the Wilmington Quakers. 13 minutes left in this third quarter. Sends Wynn in motion to the backfield. Takes the snap. Looking to pass. Short drop. And he's going to be brought down to the backfield. Sekou Amani gets there again. And wow, he's on a tear.
He's on a defensive player of the week kind of tear, as that is sack number 4 of the game. He has 4.5 tackles for lost yardage and 2 forced fumbles. Sekou Amani is having a game to remember.
And that makes third down even tougher. That's a drive stopper right there by Sekou Amani. Third down and long. Larimer in the shotgun. Sends Wynn back into the backfield on the left side. Takes the snap, looking to pass now on third down and long. Escapes the pocket, throws deep downfield into the end zone, incomplete.
Yeah, Ian Mitchell was there on the coverage of Ace Taylor, and that really did not give Larimer any kind of throwing lane.
So the BW defense comes up big after giving up a big passing play. And, you know, he thought Wilmington was getting in a rhythm on offense, and Sekou Amani was there to stop that. But they're going to stay out there on fourth down, still in striking distance in BW territory. We've seen them quick punt it a couple times with the quarterback, Larimer. Two receivers to the right. Man sent in motion is Ace Taylor. Takes the snap. Fakes the handoff. Looking outside the pocket now is Larimer. Flag down. Throws it out of bounds. And
likely a hold as Imani was taken down by two different Quakers. And you really don't see quarterbacks rolling toward Sekou Amani, his side of the field, when they're trying to bootleg out to either extend a play for a pass or to run it themselves.
Yeah, it's tough as a right-handed quarterback moving to your left to make a play. And either way, the holding call is there. A stop for the BW defense on their first possession. Out comes Keegan Armitage. Already 2 touchdowns passing on the day, 147 yards on 5 completions, 8 attempts. 2 running backs set back there. That's DJ Griffiths and John Murray Jr. 2 receivers out to the right. Sends Griffiths in motion and hands off to John Murray Jr. up the middle. Lowers his shoulder and moves it up to about the 31-yard line.
I have to believe that the Yellow Jackets, if they score here, we're not going to see much of this first-team offense for the remainder of the game.
I have to agree with you, partner. We might be seeing some new faces on the field for the Yellow Jackets as they have dominated and feel like they already put themselves in position to win, but still have Keegan Armitage in the starting offense out there. Stokes in the slot to the right. Sends Griffiths to his right. Hands off up the middle. John Murray Jr. plunges forward again, and nearing the first down, a whole bunch of Quakers there to stop him. They say move the chains, first down.
John Murray Jr. now over the 800 yards rushing mark on the year. He's well on pace to get past the 1,000-yard mark as well. If he's able to stay healthy, it'll be a nice accomplishment for a very standout player.
Snap goes off of DJ Griffiths, and the ball is on the ground. I'm not sure if that went off Armitage or Griffiths, but it looked like he was about to get the ball off the snap and just not what the BW offense wanted on their first possession.
Yeah, something was not right with the timing, and the snap went to Griffiths instead of Armitage, and Griffiths clearly wasn't expecting it. So now Wilmington is set up on a short field here, and we'll see if they can do anything positively with it.
Right back where they were on that last drive. Here's Larimer again. This time he's got Tyreek Nebbett to his right. Brings Itika Wynn back into the backfield again. Sends him in motion to the far side. Takes the snap. Looking to pass again. Fires over the middle. Caught again by Amir Jackson. Brought down for a short gain on the slant pattern.
Yeah, combining on the stop, Mason Levisor and also Tyler Tobin, sophomore linebacker out of London, Ohio.
BW defense has been rotating all sorts of guys, keeping everybody fresh. second down and short for Wilmington College. If you're just joining us, score is 28-0. BW leads it in this one. 10 minutes remaining in the third quarter. Larimer in the gun sends Jackson back into the backfield now towards the far side. Hands off up the middle. That's Nebbit. Short gain there, and there's a BW Yellow Jacket down. That's Mason Levisour, and he's going to signal to the sideline he needs to be out. He's a big-time player on this defense.
Yeah, one of the best in the middle of that defense, really an anchor for this BW team. 33 tackles coming into today.
Now third down and short for Wilmington and BW territory. They need to cash in. 4 receivers on this time for Larimer. To his right is Tyreek Nebbit. Takes the snap. Fakes the handoff, goes and takes it himself. Ball's on the ground. BW picks it up. I think his knee might have been down, but referee's motion that BW picked up that fumble on third down and short. Here comes the offense again.
Yeah, I think Jordan Smith got in there to strip the ball. And then Brandon Seawright came up to recover the ball.
BW defense picks up another turnover. And another mistake for the Wilmington Quakers in BW territory. Here's Armitage, 2 receivers to his right. Lone receiver to the left is Dez Ryan. Handoff and wanted to give it to Griffiths, but took it himself on the read option, and that time to blow up the play was Tavion Bryant.
Yeah, not sure if that was a miscommunication or just Armitage at the last second deciding to pull it down, but either way, that's 2 straight snaps where the offense has really looked out of sync, once on the fumble on the bad snap, and then now on the first down play of this drive. It's tough sledding right now for this Jackets team.
Here's Armitage in the gun. Murray to his right. Takes the snap. Fakes the handoff to Murray and throws it to Cregan. Andrew Cregan makes the catch. Makes it third down and manageable.
And just a nice little confidence-building route right there with Cregan. He's a nice safety valve. He can make some plays for this Yellow Jacket team. Came into the game with 9 catches for 43 yards and a touchdown.
Cregan, a really important part of this BW offense. Not only does he catch the ball, he's a lead blocker out of the backfield too. Here's Armitage, looking to pass on third down and long. Escapes the pocket, fires out to the right, nearly intercepted, but bounces out of bounds. That's going to bring out the punting unit for BW.
Yeah, that play could have gone all sorts of badly for the Yellow Jackets, but fortunately for Armitage, the ball sailed out of bounds. Jake Novak was the closest Yellow Jacket to it, and he was well deep of the out route.
Now we'll get to see the power of Cuppage. We've seen him punt it a couple of times inside the 20. Jackets trying to flip the field position here. Offside is going to be called on Wilmington. Boot is up. Dribbles at the 40. Doesn't get the best bounce, and the ball is spotted at the 37. You have to think that BW is going to accept that offsides penalty and re-kick that.
Yeah, absolutely. The Cuppage did not get a hold of it like they wanted him to. And again, it looked like it was altered some kind of way. I don't think it was blocked, but I think the rush maybe gave him pause, and that shortened up that kick considerably.
And now the referees are talking this one out. Not sure.
Nobody wins when that happens.
Yeah. Not sure what the call would be if it wasn't offsides. Looked pretty clear.
Well, I guess the question is, did BW draw him offsides? But in that case, then the play should have been blown dead right where it was.
Still a long conversation on the field.
It just got longer. They brought in the side judge, too, and now the umpire's coming in to discuss. So now we have 4 officials, 4 out of the 6. Yep, make that 5. Oh, my goodness.
We're going to add that five on to the end of the kick there. So we're going to see the ball at around maybe the 32-yard line. There's no false start on the defense, so I'm assuming that was encroachment.
It was encroachment, but either the Yellow Jackets would take the penalty and re-kick. I guess I didn't know that that was an option, that you could tack it on the end of a play. That's definitely something I've seen for the first time.
Regardless, Larimer out to try to end this shutout. In the backfield now is Dallas Rawlings. Larimer takes the snap, play action, throws on the screen outside. That's going to be brought in by Atika Wynn Jr., and the BW defense is there to pursue.
And just a simple short route for a positive gain. Actually, no gain. So BW did a good job to sniff it out. That intermediate passing game might be time to start going for that a little bit more often if you're Wilmington, because I think BW is starting to key in on that short yardage passing situation.
They had to have run that wide receiver screen maybe six times at the end of the half, and another sack fumble. Football's on the ground. Who's going to pick it up? BW says they have it. The fumble was forced by Nick Pankow. Who else other than him? And BW football.
And Tyler Tobin coming in from his middle linebacker spot to get the recovery. Excellent job right there by him to locate it and then hold on to it while he was at the bottom of the pile. And that is never an advantageous situation for anybody, but credit the young man, the sophomore, with the recovery.
Larimer had two fumbles coming into this game. He has two in the game now.
Three. Actually, he had two in the first half, and that was fumble number three on the game.
We talked about how that's job number one. Larimer struggling today. Armitage now takes the snap. John Murray Jr. up the middle. About a four-yard gain. That's been the typical first down play for this BW Yellow Jackets team.
Well, when something works and you like it, why not keep going back to it, I guess. Is the theory. I mean, John Murray Jr., until you prove that you can stop him consistently, he's going to try to wear you out.
He's already carried the ball 22 times. We'll get that yardage added on in a second, averaging about 6.5 yards per carry. Armitage in the gun, hands off again to John Murray Jr. on the outside. Cregan makes the block, and the first down is gained.
To emphasize your point earlier, Cregan is just a great lead blocker. That is the kind of guy that, as a running back, you want to follow behind because you know he's going to be in the right spots and he's going to do the job that springs you for a big game.
Trips to the left on first down and goal. Keegan Armitage takes it himself up the middle. Ball spotted at the 3-yard line. Second down and goal. Cregan tight to the right side. Hand off to John Murray Jr. Tries to put the ball forward to get into the end zone. Can't do it.
I think he gained about 1 yard on that. He is finding some tough sledding between the tackles today. And it's fairly evident that Wilmington made it priority number one to keep number 34 from completely wrecking the game.
Third down and goal for Keegan Armitage. Hands off again. John Murray Jr. up the middle into the end zone. Touchdown, Yellow Jackets. That's number three for John Murray Jr. The hat trick.
BW finally capitalizing on a mistake from the Quakers deep in their own territory as they get set up on a short field and then find their way into the end zone.
After the fumble, that was a 6-play, 70-yard drive. On for the extra point is Dean Saris. Missed on a 35-yard field goal at the near end of the half. This one is up and it is good. High snap. And Waymer does a nice job getting the hold down.
Yeah, right now Waymer's having some words with one of the Wilmington Quakers because he was picking himself up off the turf after a block attempt. He wasn't happy about taking that hit.
He's done a nice job. A couple of high snaps in this game. He's been able to get down.
Yeah, it hasn't been the cleanest special teams game, but credit to Waymer. I don't think that miss was the field goal attempt was on him. He's been able to get those snaps down and really do a good job with giving Sarah's an opportunity to make the kicks.
35-0 the score now in Berea. Luke Schradel alongside Matt Florjancic for this one. While they're taking a look around the league in the stadium, we will as well. A couple of games going on in the Ohio Athletic Conference. A couple of games that have already finished. John Carroll beat Marietta 19-10. Capital on top of Ohio Northern. That's a big score that people are going to be looking at. 35-28. Capital gets a win in conference. Mount Union took on Heidelberg, beat them 49-14. Muskingum took down Otterbein. And the only game going on right now is this one. Jackson takes it at the 5-yard line, up past the 20 now. Around the 26 is where they'll spot him, 25. 4:54 remaining in the third quarter. Quakers have been able to move the ball successfully in the second half, but when they get into BW territory, that defense is locked up.
They sure have, and really it's a credit to the pass rush of the defensive ends, Jordan Smith and Sekou Amani, and then the interior pressure that they're getting because Teano Orocho is absolutely everywhere on the field. He's chasing down wide receivers on short routes. He's busting up plays at the line of scrimmage. BW's really taking advantage of that front four.
Tim Triplett Jr. comes into the game, the 6'5 junior, hands off to Ben Hobbs. Hobbs around the outside. They're going to give him the 28-yard line. Second down coming.
Yeah, great gain of 3 yards on the play.
But they make a switch at quarterback. Haven't seen.
Triplett's a 6'5", 201-pound junior who's completed 8 of his 18 throws for 67 yards. Has one interception, and he has one rush for negative 2 yards coming into the game.
Here's Triplett now on second down. Hands off again. That's Hobbs. Hobbs taking Yellow Jacket tacklers past the first down yard marker. He's going to pick up a first down. Tough running from Ben Hobbs.
That end of that play resembled more of a rugby scrum than it did a football play. But credit Hobbs to just continue to push the pile. That's not easy to do when you've got about 10 guys piled up in front of you, but he was able to do it.
That's the second time Wilmington has picked up a first down running the ball. 123 total yards for this offense so far. Their big struggle has been third down, 0 of 8. Haven't had one yet on this drive. Here's Triplett. Two receivers to the right. One lone to the far side. Takes the snap. Hands it off again. That's Dobbs. Hobbs up the middle. Nothing really going there on the run.
Nope. Teano Orocho again coming up with a big stop.
Triplett get in the play from the sideline, second down and long. 3 receivers set, 1 tight end. Lathan Jones out alone to the far side. Triplett, play action. That was an RPO. Looking for the bubble screen. His main man, Itika Wynn Jr., doesn't make the catch. And BW has really done a nice job of adjusting to defend that play.
Yeah, there was enough time for him to set his feet, but he quick-fired it out. trying to find an open man and just was off the mark with it. If he plants his back foot, he might have a more accurate throw.
It feels like 50 degrees out here with a 10-mile-per-hour wind. You're coming off the bench as a quarterback. It's tough to get warmed up.
Yeah.
Third down and 10. Triplet looking to pass. Nothing opens. Rolling out. Throws it. Nearly intercepted. He was looking for Lathon Jones. Can't hook up with him. Fourth down coming.
Yeah, Jordan Smith just missed the sack as he dove right at Triplett's leg but was not able to get a hand on him. And then Brandon Seawright was right there on the coverage to make that pass very difficult to complete.
Not the greatest of starts for Triplett on his first drive. Aaron Pardo to kick it away. Kick flying out towards the far side and gets a BW bounce and retrieved by Amir Jackson. He'll spot it at the 37-yard line. Interested to see if BW comes out with a different look on offense this time, up 35, Matt.
Yeah, I'm interested to see how they play it. And it looks like Murray Jr. and Armitage are leading the huddle out of the onto the field, and that's the first team offensive line as well. So first team offense still getting some work. You gotta balance if you're Jim Hilvert getting these guys, you know, into that fourth quarter and having them experience that versus keeping them healthy.
Swing pass out to Cregan. He breaks a tackle, and he's brought down. That time was Jared Lee coming up to make the tackle. Listed as a linebacker, plays a lot of safety. Here's Keegan Armitage on second down and long. Hands off Murray up the middle. And he's going to be brought down. Tavion Bryant was there to make the stop.
Nice solid run for a gain up to the 45-yard line. So third and two for this Yellow Jacket team.
It's been a quick third quarter.
Sure has. It's been a quick game, truthfully. That first half got done inside of an hour. So that tells you, when both of these teams are running the football, that clock ticks down pretty fast.
Armitage handoff again to John Murray. He's going to pick up the first down yardage. That's BW's 19th first down in this game.
I mean, they are just churning the yards out on the ground and continue to take that clock and run it. And they legitimately only have to run two more plays.
Another handoff. Murray breaks the tackle. Up past the 50, and he turned nothing into something. Nice gain on second down.
He sure did. He shrugged off a one defender, pushed through another, and then tried to jump swim move over a third before he was brought down after a gain of 8. And he gets pulled to the sideline, and he gets a hearty greeting from one of the Yellow Jacket coaches there.
Here's Armitage, second down and short. Griffiths in the backfield. Armitage will take it himself and dives forward for a first down. Quarterback takes a hit on a running play like that. You get a little bit concerned, but Keegan's a guy that's been able to take those types of hits. And there's two Quakers down on the field.
I think they hit each other trying to stop Armitage. And it was just all sorts of collisions going on there.
It's Tavion Bryant and Traquez Parks down. Bryant's able to get up under his own power.
Parks is sitting up with his helmet off, and he's talking to the trainers. Looks like he's pointing at his lower right leg.
Nineteen seconds left on this third quarter clock. Parks is able to stand up under his own power. And he'll walk off. It's a good sign to see those guys walk off.
Very good to see. Anytime you get two of the teammates injured on the same play, you know that a collision between the two was probably the cause, and bad things can happen when you're not expecting them like that.
And wanted the clock to start running. It didn't start. Now it does. I think this is where the third quarter will end for us. 35-0 the score. Hook Schradl, Matt Florjancic on BWYellowJackets.com. We'll be right back at the start of the fourth quarter. All set to go for this fourth quarter at the George Finnie Stadium. We'll give you a little scoring recap here in this one. 35-0 is the score. Darius Stokes started things off with a 68-yard catch from Keegan Armitage for a touchdown. And John Murray Jr. got in the end zone twice in a row. That was the end of the first quarter, 21-0. And Ian Mitchell with a beautiful pass, beautiful catch from Keegan Armitage. That sent it to 28-0. And in this third quarter, John Murray able to get into the end zone again. 35-0 is where we're at. Here's Armitage. Hands off Griffiths up the middle. And that's a nice game for DJ Griffiths. A couple of extracurriculars after the play there. But a good push from the offensive line.
Yeah, very good push. And like you said, a little bit of extracurriculars going on there. Now, you don't want to pick up any personal fouls at this point in the game. There's no point to ever picking up one of those.
Armitage with two receivers to each side, John Murray to his left. He'll hand it off. John Murray Jr. breaks a tackle, and it's going to take four or five guys to bring him down. It just seems like he always breaks that first tackle.
Yeah, I mean, he's got a lot of power in addition to being speedy and having that ability to get to the outside. This is a young man, and once he squares his shoulders and puts his momentum into the ground by planting his foot and tries to drive forward, he's going to push you back. I mean, he's almost 200 pounds. He's 6'1". He's built almost like a linebacker in a running back's body, and just a phenomenal athlete.
Lone receiver to the left side is Vinny Lomeo. Hand off to John Murray Jr. again. He's got the first down and more. Brought down at the 20-yard line, and the chains move.
Yeah, it's nothing fancy with this offense, but it's all productive. It's all designed about moving the ball forward, and they have one of the best guys in the country at doing that in John Murray Jr.
Exactly right. That's the 17th first down running the ball for this offense. Another handoff to Murray. He makes a move around the left tackle and going to be brought down for a short gain.
Yeah, very patient run, just kind of letting the blocks set themselves up before he turns upfield. Good vision and good cutting ability right there by John Murray Jr.
Into the game is DJ Griffiths. They'll send Murray to the sideline. Second down and 7. Armitage will keep it himself, and that time the Quakers there to make the stop.
Yeah, it's amazing to me how much the Yellow Jackets have run with Armitage today, but when he's having the success that he has, I mean, you have to keep going to it. You have to keep letting him make the decisions. This is why he's your starter, and you trust him to run an RPO. You have to let him make the plays that he sees on the field, and he's been doing a great job.
That's his 11th rush for 72 yards on the game. That's a 6.5 yards per carry average. Armitage in the gun on third down and manageable. Hands this one off to DJ Griffiths. He's working around and not going to be able to pick up the first down. Ball's on the floor. I'm going to say he's down by contact. Fourth down coming. And they will bring Dean Saris out again to attempt a field goal.
And this one should be longer than the one that he was already off target on.
Looked good in warmups at the beginning of this second half. See what he can do here.
He's kicking with a bit of a crosswind coming from right to left.
Here's the snap. Hold is down. Kick is up. And it is good. Dean Saris, one of two on the day. And that gives you some confidence if you're Coach Hilver.
Yeah, no doubt. Hitting from 33 after missing from 33 earlier in the game. And that one had enough to be good from about 45, truthfully. Saris has the power in his leg. It's just a matter of placement. If he can find consistency placing his kicks, he will be one of the best kickers in Division III.
That one was right down the middle. 38-0 now the score. It's the first score of this fourth quarter. And this time Wilmington will get it back. And they've had trouble moving the ball with anything. They have 135 total yards. They've ran 46 plays and average about 2.9 yards per play. You compare that to BW, they have 7.3 yards per play on 423 total yards.
I mean, that tells you the difference right there. That's a whole lot of yardage that is left on the table if you're Wilmington, and also on the defensive side of the ball, giving up way too much to this Yellow Jacket team, who doesn't need much help, mind you, to move the ball down the field.
Saris with a high kick. Going to be caught around the 21-yard line. And that's a big return. Up past the 50, and Saris drives him back inside. He's going to be brought down at around the 41-yard line. Yeah, that was Mason Jenkins.
Yeah, Jenkins caught the ball, got run into from one of his teammates from behind, caught it at the 16 and was able to get that right corner and off to the race as he went. That was a heck of a return out to the BW 43-yard line. So credit the young man with a 41-yard return.
Special teams hasn't been too bad today from the Wilmington Quakers.
That's been a bright spot. They've blocked a punt. They've had a good kickoff return. Their punting has been relatively solid. They've been able to get some good rolls to set BW up on some long fields. They've got something there on special teams.
Triplet on first down in BW territory. Deep downfield, intercepted. That time, intercepted by Robbie Williamson.
I think that's two consecutive games now for Williamson with a pick. I believe he had one last week as well. And then he returned at 41 yards and was stopped at the one. And according to Coach Hilvert, he got a fair bit of good-natured teasing from his teammates after that, watching that in film session last week.
That's another turnover for Wilmington Quakers offense that couldn't afford to have another. Triplet with his second interception on the season. Really missed his target there. Williamson did a nice job of tracking that ball down.
He sure did. That was a difficult ball to track because you don't want to get too far off the wide receiver and have something weird happen. And he had his back to the line of scrimmage and was able to kind of almost over the shoulder catch it to haul in the interception. So good bit of work right there by Williamson. That was not an easy pick.
Reese Wehmer on to play quarterback for this possession. Handoff Griffiths. About a 9-yard gain on first down.
Yeah, that's a good start to this drive right there. Power running inside. And that's something that we talk about with John Murray is the mix of speed and power. Griffiths has it too. He's more of the speed guy, but he can push it up between the tackles. Don't let him fool you. He has some power in those legs.
Wehmer trips left. Hands off Griffiths. DJ out side, and it's going to be brought down for no gain. Third down coming.
Only so much you can do when you have two and three defenders hanging on you. You can only power them down the field so many times. Third and short now for this Yellow Jacket team, and you know they want to convert here and keep Wilmington's defense on the field.
Greg Perry's in the slot to the right. Reese Wehmer in the backfield to take the snap. He'll hand off Griffiths up the middle, and ball popped out. I don't think the ref saw it that way.
No, they did not. The far official on the the official on the far side of the field, rather, signals fourth down.
So the BW offense with a three and out. Cuppage on to do the punting. Back to receive this one, Gavin Fouché. Kick nearly gets away, just not the power he wanted into that one, a high kick, and didn't even get into Wilmington territory, but Cuppage is down.
Yeah, and he's grabbing at his kicking foot. It looked like it came off awkwardly. I don't know if he was touched or landed on it funny, but just that kick did not look good, and Cuppage does not look good as he's trying to get to the sideline. He's in a considerable amount of discomfort.
Training staff will attend to him while this Wilmington Quaker offense comes out in BW territory. 38-0 the score, 8:54 remaining in the game. That's Tyreek Nebbitt on the carry. He's going to pick up about 5 yards on first down. Second down and five coming for Wilmington.
It seems like that's been the story for Wilmington's offense. On many of their drives, they have a very good first down play, and then they can't follow it up with a good play on second down. I think that's really what this offense is missing from being more consistent and moving down the field and being able to put up some points. We're not seeing that consistency play in and play out in the results.
Two receivers left, triplet in the gun. He'll hand off again. That's Nebbitt. Nebbitt breaks forward, and he's going to break it past the 30-yard line and move the chains for a first down.
And this is an opportunity for Wilmington here to stack good plays after good plays and, you know, get something positive established here in this game. Obviously down 38 points with 7 minutes and change left in the fourth quarter. You're not going to come back and win this game, but you want to build on some things and get some positive things on tape to make you feel like you're heading in the right direction.
First down and 10 now. Triplet in the shotgun. Bunch receivers trio to the left. Handoff again with Nebbitt. Nebbitt breaks outside. And he's going to pick up another first down inside the red zone.
I think Wilmington has something here with Nebbitt. He was not on there too deep at running back or halfback, but this is a young man who's made a lot of plays today against a defense that doesn't allow many big plays.
Coming into the game, he had 31 runs for 125 yards. He did have one lost fumble. Maybe that would be why the coaching staff hasn't trusted him as much, but a promising young player for the Wilmington Quakers. Here's Triplett. Sends Ace Taylor in motion. He'll hand it to him on the jet sweep, and that time the Jackets were there to make the play.
Yeah, coming up to make the hit was Dylan Timmons. Did a good job to get the stop.
His second tackle for a loss in this game.
There's a lot of young men for BW that has a TFL attached to their names after this one. It's been a really phenomenal effort up front by all these young men.
Triplet on second and long now. Nebbitt's still in there to his right. He'll fake the handoff and swing it out to Atika Wynn Jr., who gets a nice block on the outside, nearly picks up the first down. And they'll spot him at the 10-yard line. Third down and short.
You got to believe there is after the result of this play, if Wilmington doesn't get a first down, it's four down territory. You have nothing to lose.
Here's Triplett. Hand off to Nebbitt, and he's brought down to the backfield. That's going to make it a tougher fourth down.
Yeah, Cooper Stein coming up from the linebacker spot, the sophomore out of Port Clinton, just wrapping and dropping Nebbitt right in the backfield.
Fourth down and long now inside the red zone. This drive started about 4 minutes ago, and a chance to score here in the red zone for Wilmington. Triplett looking to pass on fourth down, deep into the end zone. Did he get a foot down? Yes, he did. Touchdown, Wilmington.
Ace Taylor with a great route to draw some of the attention away, and that allowed Wynn Jr. to get the reception. And wow, I don't know how he got his foot down in bounds, but he did, and the official gave him credit for it. That was a phenomenal play all the way around. Good throw, good catch.
And that's one of the positives you're talking about, taking it away from this game. You bring in your backup quarterback, and he makes a nice throw on fourth down and long in the red zone.
He sure did. That's not an easy throw. Don't get it confused with being an easy throw. Not at all. The back shoulder fade to the back line. I mean, you have to be on point. If you underthrow it, it's going back the other way.
And the extra point is good. 38-7 now the score. Wilmington gets on the board in this fourth quarter.
And it's the first touchdown BW has allowed in their last two home games. They shut out Capital previously 51-0, and then they were up 38-0, now 38-7 over Wilmington. But that was a good sustained drive from this Quaker team. You have to give them some credit. You know, down 38 points, you could very easily fold up the tent and go home. But these guys are out there, they're playing hard, and during the breaks, they're listening to the music. And if they're not in a huddle, they're having a good time just messing around with each other. And, you know, that's really what collegiate athletics is about. And it's good to see that despite their record and their lack of success, this Wilmington team is committed to fighting to the end here.
Can't get down on yourself. Seven plays, 43 yards, and a touchdown for Wilmington College. Back to return this kick for BW. Greg Perry's alongside Elijah Arnett. Also could be Corey Dick. And a short kick recovered by BW. BW does not have a number 59 on the roster.
They have one on the field, and he was responsible for recovering that kick.
Sure-handed by a guy that doesn't exactly wear a number that you would expect to catch the ball.
Not exactly. No, you're expecting a D-end or maybe a right guard with that kind of number, but he was able to corral the ball and get the possession for the Jackets.
And Wehmer will start inside Wilmington territory at the 49-yard line. First down and 10 with 5 minutes remaining in the fourth. Keeps it himself on the outside. He's got some running room. Wehmer on the outside, down inside the 20.
And he's going to get some extra yards because I think he was pulled down by his face mask.
Some speed on the outside from the guy that usually holds kicks. Made a nice read and turned it up. Awaiting the call from our officials. And you're exactly right, partner. That'll move the ball 15 yards forward inside the red zone.
Down to the Wilmington 13-yard line.
Wehmer in there. To his right is Jaden Harris. Takes the snap, hands off to him, and He's going to plunge into the end zone. Did he get there? No. They say he's down at the one.
That was not the most advantageous spotting for BW right there, as that ball looked like it crossed, but they're going to say his knee was down inside the one. I don't think that ball could get much closer to the goal line without going over.
And with this BW offensive line, it's easy from 1 yard out. Waymer in the gun.
Supposed to be easy.
Takes the snap, hands off to Harris, and Wilmington comes up and makes a play on first down and goal. He'll say tackle for a loss. Move it back to the 3 yard line.
Yeah, that was a loss of 3 on the play. There was nothing really Harris could do. He essentially ran into 3 defensive linemen right at the point of attack, and anytime you do that, you're likely going backward.
Waymer on second down and goal, trips to the right. Takes the snap, keeps it himself up the middle, spins, still alive, and going to be brought down at the 1. BW quarterbacks have been breaking a lot of tackles today, Matt.
They sure have, and they have been making plays up the field, just really doing a good job with that, taking care of business and giving the quarterbacks room to run. I mean, they've just been very cautious with the football, but also very willing to try and move it down the field.
Harris to Waymer's right. Lone receiver on the left side is Richie Knock. Waymer takes the snap, hands off to Harris, and Waymer's going to try to push him into the end zone. He can't get there. Fourth down and goal coming for BW.
I love the assist attempt right there by Waymer. He saw his guy needing a little bit of a boost, and he was trying to provide it. You don't expect a guy his size, 5'10", 170 pounds, to be able to push a pile, but he was able to get at least a positive gain on that play.
On to do the kicking now. They'll give Dean Saris a chance. His third attempt of the day. A little bit of a shorter one around extra point territory here. Be around a 20-yarder. Waymer gets the snap down. Kick is up, and it is good. And on 3 more to that 38 total. We're at 41-7.
Another good effort by this Yellow Jacket team, putting up 40-plus points again at home. When you look at what they've been able to do this season, I mean, when they score this many points, they are definitely in good shape. They were 5-0, soon to be 6-0 when they score at least 20 points, and they surpassed that a while ago.
But 2 stops in the red zone for Wilmington. They've allowed just 2 field goals here in this fourth quarter. If you're looking at the quarter, Wilmington's up by 1 point in this quarter. They've trying and playing some better football, although they are going against a couple of second-teamers.
Yeah, but credit that second-team offensive line, though. I know the Yellow Jackets weren't able to punch it in, but you know, Cole Bryan, the left tackle, Luke Bridegam, the left guard, Nate Samblin at the center, Jimmy Vargas, right guard, and Dante Castagna, the right tackle. They really did some good work there to open some running lanes for Reese Waymer, the quarterback.
Saris will kick off from the 35. Long kick moving to the far side, recovered by Kuiman. Excuse me, that's Clark, and he's lit up.
He sure is, and he didn't even get back to the 20-yard line. That's a hard bit of sledding against this Yellow Jacket special teams coverage unit. Bonte Jackson coming up with the stop.
.153 remaining in this one. 41-7 is the score. Different quarterback on this time for Wilmington. Handoff on the outside. Excuse me, that's triplet.
These are not the friendliest uniforms to try and read.
I agree with you, partner.
The neon green numbers on dark hunter green shoulders, not the easiest to depict. I agree with you. It didn't look like Triplett was back there. I thought maybe one of the wide receivers had lined up as in a wildcat formation, but that wasn't the case.
Triplett's still out there, three receivers in the game. He'll hand off this time. Ben Hobbs has got a lot of running room. Excuse me, that's Dallas Rawlings, and he's still going inside the 25-yard line. That's a big-time chunk run for the Wilmington Quakers. They still have some energy left in this fourth quarter, and they're just trying to get something positive.
Yeah, well, a 58-yard run from Rawlings will do just that. That run alone eclipsed what Wilmington's entire offense was in the first half. And for a bigger guy, he sure had some wheels, too. He was able to pull away from second and third level defenders before he was tracked down. Impressive play.
5'10", 200-pound freshman. Here's Triplett to pass on first down. Looking end zone. And pass interference is going to be called.
Could be called on either direction, truthfully, and we'll see what the officials say. If it's against BW, Wilmington set up pretty well. If it's against Wilmington, should be an offset, truthfully. I think in a perfect world, that's what it should be.
My opinion, that was uncatchable.
Yeah, I can see that point, too, very, very much so. I mean, when the ball sails that far out of the back of the end zone, I mean, realistically, is a guy going to be able to catch it? Apparently the back judge felt he could, though. Just flag Sam Severino with the pass interference.
That'll bring Wilmington all the way inside the red zone at the 9-yard line. First down and goal. 27 seconds left on this game clock. Triplett takes the snap, looks end zone, too far.
He had Jackson with inside position. That's just putting too much on it. He needs to put more finesse on that throw because Jackson had done a good job to get the inside on a defender, and there was nobody between him and the ball.
Seconds left now. Wilmington getting the play from the sideline. Triplett will have three receivers on one tight end with Rawlings to his left. Takes the snap, looking. And he's going to be brought down for a sack. BW defense holds, and that might be the last play you see in this one. 15 seconds left on the clock.
Cooper Stein with the sack. That's his second TFL this half. He's played a really good bit of football here in limited duty.
Triplett wants to run another play, but the clock does not let him. And the final score, 41-7. BW takes this one against the Wilmington Quakers.
Yeah, that's a good way to close out the game for the Yellow Jackets. Good win coming back home after a long road trip last week. You have two home games back-to-back. You start off that set with a victory over Wilmington, and you look forward. You have Marietta next week before you go on the road for your final time during the regular season against Ohio Northern, and then wrap up the regular season at home against your cross-county rivals.
Yeah, the goal is to get there unscathed by anyone but Mount Union so far, and they did a good job of doing that today. The only mark on this game that I thought was imperfect was maybe that fumble at the beginning of the game, but otherwise it was perfectly played until late in this fourth quarter where Wilmington just showed some effort.
Yeah, it had some pride, and you know that's what you want to see. You want to see guys that play with pride. When you're 0-6, now 0-7, you want to find out who's going to slug it out in the trenches for 60 full minutes, and those are the kind of guys that you feel could help build a program. Unfortunately for the Yellow Jackets, they have a lot of those guys already, and they did what they had to do to be successful today, and you have to give them credit because they came out and they handled business right from the start. Even with that fumble on the first drive of the game, they came back and had four straight scoring drives to really put their exclamation point on this victory.
Taking a look at some individual stats, Keegan Armitage was 7 for 11, 158 yards and two touchdowns. The leading rusher, John Murray Jr., 31 attempts, 174 yards, along with three touchdowns. Yet another big day for him that will see him surely climb up the national books in terms of touchdowns. As far as receivers go, Darius Stokes, two catches, 87 yards and a touchdown on a 68-yard hookup. Take a look at the defense. Sekou Amani had a great day today. Six total tackles, five tackles for a loss, including a bunch of fumbles forced. And he had four sacks to go along with that. Nick Panko had two sacks. Whole defense got involved today, and that is what moves BW to 6-1 on the year. They get the win over the Wilmington Quakers, 41-7. Thank you for joining us, Luke Schradel, alongside Matt Florjancic. We thank you for listening, and enjoy the rest of your Saturday.